part of our talk today and entertain some questions.
You gave us a very elegant understanding of East and West, and I'm thinking North-South, that it's not only Europe, but you have the Middle East there. So how does this fit in with the politics of Syria, Iran? I mean, this is pretty close by.
Well, that's an interesting question. Watching the Syrian crisis come to a very dangerous stage in August of last year, when President Obama drew a red line and we were expecting some form of American intervention in the war, it was interesting to watch how that dangerous moment passed and gave way to something like a negotiated process where the Russians and the Americans successfully worked together to start removing chemical weapons from the Syrian arsenal. A familiar pattern. You come to the brink of a big confrontation, and then you kind of shrink from the brink and step back and then work together to achieve a goal which both countries have shared. Now, the Syrian crisis is an interesting case in point, because just as Ukraine, it's very difficult to contain or control. And also, it's more difficult than Ukraine because of so many outside players being involved, from Saudi Arabia and Iran and other forces. Yes, Al-Qaeda, of course. So it is a conflict that has acquired a momentum of its own, and it's another of those tests of the international community and the major powers, the test of whether they can contain their competitive instinct and think of these crises not in terms of a zero-sum game, but in terms of shared interests in bringing this crisis to resolution. Iran is a difficult...
But are they related, that concern with Ukraine?
No,
because,
absolutely not. Even though some observers have packaged them together and see similarities between them, I don't see real connections either in terms of the reality on the ground or in terms of policy making. For instance, one could, if they were tightly related in terms of U.S. foreign policy making, you could imagine, okay, now that Putin has grabbed Crimea, let's go and grab Syria, just to make a point. But nobody is thinking along these lines. As far as Iran is concerned, that is a particularly interesting case because, again, thanks in part to cooperation between Russia and the United States, there is a real prospect of improving relations between the normalizing relations between the United States and Iran. Now, why would Russia be interested in helping the Iranians normalize relations with the United States? Because they have a close relationship with Iran. So according to some thinkers who think about it in zero-sum terms, say, actually, the Russians are not interested. They are interested in the controlled tensions between Iran and the United States. Well, but those people forget that everybody in this world of ours is trying to play multi-vector, multipolar games. You never put your eggs in one basket. Iranians are keen on normalizing relations with the United States, but not at the expense of their relations with Russia. In fact, the better they manage their relations with Russia, the better able they are to negotiate with the United States. This is the same thing that the Chinese and the Russians and the Americans have done, another of those triangles. And there are many other places where they play these kinds of games. What works for you is having as many partners as possible and then balancing your policies between those partners. I find it interesting how Pakistan is now busily repairing its relations with Russia in particular in terms of getting weapons. Now, Russia has a long time and deeply entrenched friendly relationship with India. And once you begin to work with Pakistan and sell them some weapons, you have to make sure that you don't lose your Indian friends. But if you're a good diplomat, you can do that. And in fact, you can actually contribute to an improvement of relations between India and Pakistan if you address those relations in regional terms. Because all neighbors there, with China, Afghanistan, and Central Asian states, Iran, by the way, which is just next door, if you address the relationships, bilateral conflicts in particular, in that part of the world, in terms of a development of a regional framework focused on cooperation and mutual security, you can find all kinds of interesting solutions, which is another benefit of the Cold War having receded into the past. It's not a bipolar world anymore.
I'm wondering if our experience with the Georgian crisis of a couple of years ago has anything to teach us about what could happen here with the Ukraine. Is there perhaps a good model there in our reactions to that, or a bad model, I wonder?
The Georgian crisis, and I have to very briefly remind people what the Georgian crisis was, in August of 2008, the Georgian government, relying, they thought, on the support of the United States government, moved to retake control of one of the breakaway regions of Georgia, which had behaved almost as independent states backed by Russia for almost two decades. They tried to do so, and in the course of doing so, they killed a dozen Russian peacekeepers who were stationed in that region called South Ossetia by international agreement. In response to that, the Russians sent a division into South Ossetia, and then that division, having defeated the Georgians in South Ossetia, they moved on to the Georgian territory. And it was a very dangerous moment because there was a possibility that there would be a direct military clash between Russia and the United States. As we now know from published sources, that Vice President Cheney in particular thought that once the Russians moved their forces across their border into the territory of Ukraine, of Georgia, that the United States should use its air force and bomb the Russian deployments. And there was a robust debate in the administration as to whether that was a wise move or not. And according to some sources, Laura Bush played a decisive role, and we know how influential Laura Bush was on the president. It was interesting that thanks to the very skillful diplomatic intervention of President Sarkozy of France and other European leaders, there was a negotiated resolution of the conflict. And the status quo was actually not too significantly changed, because these breakaway territories, South Ossetia and the other one, Abkhazia, which felt that they were the next target of this Georgian action, they were de facto independent. Now they became formally independent, and Russia recognized their independence. But those territories had been lost to Georgia a long time ago. So what were the lessons? One important lesson from that crisis was that in NATO, they recognized that perhaps there was insufficient degree of attention to Russian sense of insecurity in the face of NATO enlargement, because Georgia was busily preparing itself for becoming a member of NATO. So it was not accidental that within months of that little war, there was an initiative at the NATO level to start a new negotiation on developing new cooperative arrangements between Russia and NATO. And a year later, a NATO-Russian Council was created. And in fact, they signed a remarkable declaration, the two sides, where they declared that they did not consider each other enemies. So on the one hand, it was a crisis which demonstrated the dangers of this shifting balance between Russia and the West in the borderline areas such as Georgia and Ukraine. And at the same time, it showed that the West had to take Russian security interests more seriously. Now, if we jump to the Ukrainian crisis and ask whether those lessons were learned, it is really difficult to apply, because what triggered off the Ukrainian crisis was the fact that Ukraine is deeply split between its pro-Western and pro-Russian parts of the population. And in fact, on any given day, a majority is pro-Russian, a minority living mostly in the West is pro-Western. And the issue at the time was whether or not Ukraine should sign a cooperation agreement with the European Union, which would have provided the opening of Ukrainian markets to Western goods, as well as the opening to Western markets to Ukrainian goods. But it's not a one, it's not a two-way street, frankly speaking. So Russia felt that this kind of free market arrangement would put in question Russian economic interests, so they would have to raise duties, custom duties, on Ukrainian goods and other goods coming from Ukraine. So also this arrangement with the European Union threatened to destroy what remains of Ukrainian industry, because it was plainly incompetitive with industries of Europe. So it was a policy decision, and the government, led by President Yanukovych, decided that they will continue to bargain with Europe for better terms, for more serious compensation for the economic damage, hoping that by balancing Russia against Europe and Europe against Russia, they would improve their own negotiating position. If it had been a smart government, it could have probably pulled it off. But unfortunately, the government turned out to be absolutely unprepared for the severe political crisis which ensued from its decision to postpone the signing of the agreement. And so as a result of a mere policy decision having things to do with free trade, customs duties, terms of economic integration, they went to the overthrow of the government and the failure of a state and then loss of territory. And then the prospect of a serious civil war, which to me was a sign of something I was not aware of. The Ukrainian state exists more in the virtual reality than in real reality. It's an extremely fragile contraption. Who created the Ukrainian state? Well, we know, Comrade Lenin and Comrade Stalin. They constructed Ukraine as one of the Union republics of the Soviet Union from some of the territories which were historically populated by Ukrainians and some of the territories which were historically populated by the Russians. And they drew those borders, which didn't mean anything because it was all part of the country which was called the Soviet Union. So the administrative borders there were not really significant. And they were not based on ethnicity anyway. Mix and match was the approach. You balance one ethnicity with another and you think you make that territory more governable. So once the Ukraine emerged from the dissolution of the Soviet Union as an independent state, they were stuck with severe issues of just defining what the hell Ukraine is. What is Ukrainian identity? And just as an illustration of how big and expansive Ukrainian nationalist thinking is, one of the leading candidates for the presidency of Ukraine, this famous woman with a braid, Yulia Tymoshenko, stated in speech 2 days ago that what this election is all about is not about who will govern Ukraine. It's about the future of the world. Because she is trying to become president to make Ukraine the starting point of the global transformation within 10 or at most 20 years, where the new type of human beings will emerge that will show the rest of humanity the path to bright future. What has she been smoking? This is a sign, by the way. I mean, imagine a Swiss election. If Swiss is a confederation, Switzerland is a confederation. I mean, do they need this type of rhetoric to keep themselves together in one piece? No. But it's a big issue because a failed state is prone to conflict. It's prone to the escalation of conflict, possibly to the stage of civil war. What do we do with our competitive interests in our response to that? So this is much worse than Georgia. This is some lessons can be drawn from that crisis. But frankly, when you look at the complexity of the Ukrainian crisis, and you then think back of those days in August of 2008, you can sigh. I wish it had been another Georgia instead of big and unruly wild field of Ukraine.
I would be interested if you could discuss the situation of Europe versus Soviet Union. Soviet Union depends monoclonally on gas and oil.
Are you talking about Russia or Soviet Union?
Russia. Russia, and they have a business of $400 billion a year. The strongest representative of Europe is Chancellor Merkel. Will the United States, in this struggle, be able to compensate with their development of cracking oil and get some kind of emancipation from the Near East and help Europe in this?
That's a great question. And this is a topic which until very recently was never discussed. It's like a new wild card which has just been thrown on the table. And it's not only about the shale oil and shale gas, it's also about the enormous strategic reserve of oil that the United States has accumulated. In fact, in the past month or so, the United States has released a considerable amount of oil from that resource to demonstrate to the Russians that the United States possesses economic capacity to affect global oil prices, or at least to try and affect. I was surprised when I heard President Obama declare that the United States is technically prepared to compensate using its shale resources to compensate Europe and Ukraine for the potential loss of Russian resources.
They have to change the law.
Yeah, you have to change the law. There's enormously weighty economic interests involved. Also, the question of prices, global prices on oil and gas is, it's a little bit like a Rube Goldberg machine. You remember where all kinds of elements are uneasily connected together, and then you are trying to affect something, you unleash a process, and then it ends in something very different. I don't think that the capacity, the mechanism for this kind of decisive action to change the energy balances in Europe is in the cards as yet. But as a stated goal, it merits attention, and I can imagine that with proper kind of leadership, the United States might emerge as the energy superpower of the 21st century. It's quite possible, and for Russia, of course, this is actually very helpful, because reliance of energy exports has become like a drug addiction. It has created massive corruption in Russia. It has spoiled the Russians. It has undercut the periodic attempts by at least some of the Russian elites to finally, you know, go to the real business of reindustrialization, 21st century reindustrialization, utilize the technologies that it has, develop new technologies in cooperation with others or on their own. So actually, the Ukrainian crisis and the possibility of serious sanctions against Russia has stimulated this discourse about, hey, you know, it's about time that we moved away from the oil and gas needle that we depend on so much. So every crisis has a silver lining, I guess.
On the other hand, Russia has an enormous potential in fracking.
Yes, it could also do that, yes.
Probably the largest in the world.
Well, this could be, except that the ecological consequences are fracking. In Canada, we are so keen on, you know, by the way, the big pipeline, which has become controversial in the United States, is also controversial on our side of the border. And in the city of Toronto, where the oil pipeline kind of cuts the city into two parts, and there are great concerns that this old pipeline might actually explode if the new oil, which is supposed to be a bit heavier than the old oil, the fracking oil, if it's pumped through that pipeline, there goes the neighborhood, and it's such a nice city, we don't want to lose it. So maybe you guys are on the right side. There's lots of sympathizers, because we have a government which is hell-bent on exporting as much oil and gas as possible. I mean, Canada as the energy superpower, one off, right? So when the Americans say, hold it, we don't want that pipeline, we say, yeah, America, help something.
I would just love to hear your thoughts on how the media is handling the crisis in Ukraine. And I'm talking about not just the Russia, which is portraying it as a overtaking of the government by right wing, but also the Western media, which is portraying itself as so ignorant of Ukraine and disseminating incorrect information. So.
Well, I've seen worse. I was impressed by an article by Stephen Cohen of New York University, which was published in The Nation magazine, and he's a longtime observer of American, the politics of the Cold War, and according to him, the kind of spinning and misrepresentation that we are witnessing now is worse than it was in the Cold War, and alternative voices are heard less than they were in the days of the Cold War. So that's kind of scary because we live in an era where there are so many sources of information. You can check everything and find an alternative source if you care to. Problem is that nobody really gives much of anything about Ukraine, let's face it. I remember, I think it was the Daily Beast that published an article somewhere in early March, the day we pretended we cared about Ukraine. So it's sort of, the crisis of the day, and that's sad. And if it has to do with a country with a complex history where it's difficult to really make sense of what's going on, then there's a natural, almost instinctive urge to explain it all in simple terms. A friend of mine in the city of Toronto, an elderly lady keenly interested in politics, and sometimes ask me to explain what the hell. So, Sergey, tell me who are the good guys, who are the bad guys. That's all what she needs to know, because then she has a compass. And I think that much of the media operates on the same principle. I mean, if these are good guys, you call them activists, like in Syria. You keep hearing about activists. The fact that there might be Al-Qaeda activists, an Al-Qaeda activist that kind of don't want that activism to spread, right? But if it's just an activist that is fighting against the government and the government is supposed to be bad, then of course. But there are some really interesting nuggets which I've found in the media coverage of the Ukrainian crisis. And I was, Washington Post a few days ago published an article about Dana Rohrabacher, the local congressman. Under the title, Putin's Friends in U.S. Congress, and it's about a number of congressmen who have been urging the U.S. Congress to adopt a more balanced position because it's not what they really think it is, Ukraine. And Dana Rohrabacher is one of those. So I thought, well, the Washington Post is kind of representing various views. And it quotes, they went and took an interview from Dana Rohrabacher, and then there is that passage at the end of the article. Oh, by the way, Congressman Rohrabacher is now embroiled in a lawsuit, over a house rental. And he turned that house into a pigsty, so it's pasty. So the owners of the house have sued him big time. And that just destroys whatever credibility Mr. Rohrabacher may have had. You know, putting that little, tidbit into the same text gives you a different perspective. I mean, what kind of people could in any way sympathize with Putin? They had to be people who turned their house rentals into pigsties. We don't want to hear from those people. So I don't know, but that's the way the media works. And again, I've seen worse.
I need to ask you about Eastern Europe. From the perspective of Poles and Hungarians and Czechs, this was not a new world order. The Cold War was a disaster. If you think about the Hungarian revolt of 1956 or the invasion of Czechoslovakia in 1968 and the East German revolt of 1953, the result of understanding at the very top between the US and the Soviet Union, even though there was a lot of disorder and conflict, felt like we are being sold out. We are being turned into the graveyard. So I'm just wondering what you think about that.
Well, I think that what you present us with is a huge, heavily one-sided view of what Eastern Europe was in the 1950s and 1960s. the losses, human losses, and the destruction of property and industrial capacity and agricultural resources in Eastern Europe during World War II was enormous. I mean, most of the fighting of the Second World War was in Eastern Europe. And the destruction was enormous. The communist regimes, which were created thanks to Soviet intervention after the Second World War, were regimes which were quite objectionable in a lot of ways, but those regimes presided over the reconstruction, rebuilding of Eastern European countries. And that was done quite effectively. And not only rebuilding of what existed, the creation of new industries, the improvement, real improvement in the material standards in a lot of ways. The creation, those were modern societies. In 1945, those societies, most of them, were in a horrible state, right? That progress cannot be just disregarded because there was the Stasi and there was the Hungarian Revolution and that there were other things like the suppression of the Prague Spring and so on. Can we embrace both sides of the fact, or do we have to argue either from the point of view, oh, those communist regimes, they were wonderful, they served the people, they improved the conditions, or those bastards were oppressing their own people and the Soviet Union always kept their tanks at the ready. Can we embrace both sides of this equation? I think we should. Otherwise, we find ourselves in an interesting ideological trap. Because of the post-Cold War discourse, which has been heavily skewed in favor of the Soviet Union and Eastern European regions, they were evil incarnate. And thank God that we freed ourselves due to our struggles, our brave struggles against those bastards. And now these countries are free and they're prospering and they're enjoying their freedom and so on and so forth. The new discourse is, whoever fought against the Soviet evil empire must have been good guys. So the Galichina division in Ukraine, why are you laughing? It's not a laughing matter. The Ukrainian Nazis were the worst overseers of the concentration camps, known for extreme brutality.
Well, I'm talking about individuals like Václav Havel, who really stood for something.
Oh, absolutely. I mean,
I would not compare them with these. Yeah.
No. What I'm talking about is that today, in many Eastern European countries, especially in the former Soviet republics like Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, or in Ukraine, in some parts of Ukraine, if you served in an SS division in World War II, I mean, or if your parents served there, then you're a national hero because you fought against the Russians. Hitler didn't matter. He was just a fellow traveler. It was a struggle for national rights against the evil Soviet Empire. Right? If you fought in the Red Army, then you're in trouble. Because they may actually take you to court for violation of human rights if you shot somebody who you not should have shot when the Soviet troops moved into the Baltics. So I would beg us all to embrace complex reality in its richness, full richness, and not try to descend to the level good versus evil. Although in every specific situation, there are often good and evil, and you make your personal choices based on that. And by the way, Václav Havel is a towering figure in the democratic revolution that took place in the communist world. It's thanks to people like that, like him, who deserves enormous credit for the liberation of Eastern Europe and the Soviet Union from communist rule, that we moved forward, we were able to move forward.
Well, I think the tragedy of Eastern Europe is that this happened 40 years after World War II, because as you know, all of these communist regimes destroyed democratic regimes.
Romania was a very democratic country in 1945. Very democratic. And we're just waiting to... And Hungary had a fascist regime that was a voluntary ally of the Third Reich. So, let's not...
Maverick Yugoslavia,
that's a whole different story with its own divisions and Serbs and Croatians killing each other on the massive scale during the war, and then try to rebuild Yugoslavia in one piece on the basis of liberal democracy in 1945 and see what happens. They tried it in 1989 and see what happened. So perhaps they were in, because this was a time of enormous, enormous destruction and suffering. There's a new book about the first post-war decade, and it's called Savage Continent. It's a historical study which was published a couple of years ago. I do not immediately remember the name of the British historian who wrote it. Savage Continent. Check it out. It's a shocking panorama of the war continuing after it supposedly ended, with massive deportations, relocations, guerrilla warfare of all kinds, massacres, and so on and so forth, not to mention the abject socioeconomic conditions which dominated across the continent of Eastern Europe. So
maybe I'm completely ignorant in making this comparison, but it seems to me that there's some decent comparisons to be made between what's going on in Ukraine, between like the comparisons to Crimea, to like Danzig in 1939, and some of the the treaty between the United States and Ukraine, and then the treaties between France and Poland in 1939 as well, and England and everything else. So do you think that the fact that we're not being plunged into, you know, on the brink of another world war, is this just a coincidence?
Yeah, the comparisons are quite striking, because some of the justification, the rationales for Hitler's expansion in the late 1930s were based on ethnic solidarity and the need to protect the rights and interests of minorities who were badly managed in countries like Czechoslovakia and so on. The big difference is that Russia today is not Nazi Germany. It's a very different animal. It's a very different state with different goals, different aims, different structure, different nature. So when we, a comparison were made between the way NATO bombed Serbia and then sent its troops to take part of Serbia, named Kosovo, out of Serbia. I remember at the time Serb propaganda and Russian propaganda was making comparison with what the Nazis were doing. See, comparisons with Nazism and with Hitler, you know, invoking another Hitler. Saddam Hussein is another Hitler. The Syrian leader Bashar Assad is another Hitler. Putin is another Hitler. They already, especially in Eastern Europe, you know, so many pictures of Putin with Hitler mustache and or with the swastika and so on. This is the currency, this is a rhetorical currency that we use, but I grant you that the similarities in terms of the way the issues are presented and the rationales for the changing of the borders, and this is deeply disturbing. So this is something that we should look at critically and start some very fundamental conversations about that. Even though, again, you can't compare Russia today with Nazi Germany. It's a very different situation. And what to me, the importance of this crisis and these upheavals is that we are more in a situation of global disorder than a situation of global order. And we must work together to make it more orderly. And maybe we need a crisis like Ukraine, because it exposed us to so many, you know, explosive kind of situation that we perhaps were not fully aware of.
Yeah, I wasn't trying to make a comparison.
No, I know, but still, you know, I was thinking about similar comparison when I, you know, with my sense of history, I said, what the hell is going on? Sudetenland? And at the same time, when I know Crimea very well, and I know the mindset in Crimea, and when I saw this wild cheering in Crimea, when Russia accepted Crimea into the Federation. You know how much cheering there was in Sudetenland when it became clear that they were joining Germany? That doesn't make the Crimean the Nazis or Putin a Hitler, but reunification. Oh, by the way, the cheering in Kosovo when they became independent from Serbia. And many of them thought that, you know, they will reunite with Albania, which hasn't happened yet, that may happen. But the thing is that borders may be changing. Listen, in 75, nations of Europe, plus United States and Canada, signed this fundamental act, the final act of the Helsinki Conference on Security and Cooperation in Europe. And they proclaim there that all the borders in Europe are final. Where is the Soviet Union? Where is Yugoslavia? And where is Czechoslovakia, by the way? And every time there's another change of the borders, somebody is happy and somebody is unhappy, and they trade those accusations and throw legal norms at each other. The Russians, who were up in arms against the idea that Kosovo may become an independent state without the permission of the government of Serbia, they thought that it was a violation of international law. The International Court at The Hague adjudicated the case. They were powerful lawyers arguing all sides of the argument. And the court came to the realization that if a territory declares independence from a state, that may violate the law of that country, but it may not be regarded as a violation of international law. Because otherwise, the birth of the United States of America would be regarded as a supremely illegal act, which some Canadians think up to this day. You know, we are loyalists. We never rebelled against King George. So, but really, it is an interesting thing. So now the Russians are invoking the Kosovo precedent. So much for consistency in the application of law. But when you're dealing with law, just, you know, check out another courtroom where the lawyers argue opposite sides.
Okay, on that, I think we really are going to have to finish out our talk. Thank you very much.